leadership. And so when we started about, this is our third year, so we're really, really, really young research station, really young university. But the first piece that we got was Dan actually got an NSF planning grant. And what that enabled us to do is bring all the stakeholders together to develop our strategic plan and mission. And that's been a huge piece for us. And so we had over about 70 to 80 folks come together and then do breakout groups and really set the priorities for what we wanted to do out here. And emphasizing that it's university-run research station, that's our priority is undergraduate research. However, everybody's invited and everybody's incorporated into this, to the research station. So we develop our mission statement, all that kind of jazz. And as we've been growing, you know, our first year we had about 1,000 user days. Second year about 3,000, and this past year we had about 5,000 user days, which is quite a bit of activity out here. And if you break up some of our major activities out here, we have educational programming. So like Sean mentioned, one thing that we've been trying to do is programming that is real world data collection. And so if you're a high school teacher or if you're a university instructor, we can plug you into ongoing programs. And it really makes it easy for people to get involved and to collect data. And so Russell mentioned long-term inventory and monitoring. And so those are the things that we've been identifying. So we have sandy beach ecology, intertidal ecology, vegetation monitoring, photo point analysis, tree demography, all these pieces and all this data is being generated by non-specialists. And so whether you're an English major or whether you're an art major, whether you're a biology major or anthropologist, you are contributing to this system. And the data you collect will ideally inform natural and cultural resource management. And so that's a big piece, is that right away, you are a scientist, but you also provide a new perspective. And so for, say, the photo point analysis, they're going out there and collecting photos of a variety of different areas associated with the hikes. We can see change through time. We can quantify that with vegetation change, ground cover, et cetera. So there's a scientific piece to that. However, we also have all these students do a reflective photo and a writing piece. And so now we can populate a map, an ArcGIS map, of these photo points, the cultural layers, the environmental science majors, but also something that many times scientists doesn't pull in, a spiritual reflection piece. And so all these photos of these students and individuals are geo-referenced and along with their writing. So we can see if certain places on these islands resonate with certain groups of people or certain emotions. And so that's an artistic piece, and that's an English piece incorporated into a scientific protocol. And so these interdisciplinary approaches are what we're all about here.
And we were just contacted by a guy, Chumash, from out of the area that's moving back that is a linguist, and he wants to give us all the historic names for all the different structures out here and locations out here. So that'll be folded in, too. And so people actually now see that as a resource, this sort of growing
And we applied for National Endowment of Arts grant, right? And so that was me, an arts teacher, and environmental science, again, having these concepts, but doing this interdisciplinary type approach. Another thing that we do out here and that we really emphasize is undergraduate research. And so that across, again, spans disciplines. And so what's great about for these students, whether they're environmental science, anthropology, business, English, is that they're working hand in hand not only with a faculty member but a professional. And that their data that they're accumulating, their project, is contributing to the park immediately, ideally. And so students who are doing a year-long capstone project really are performing master's level work, guaranteed. And provide an opportunity of not like just a project that will sit on the shelf, never get used, but immediately gets implemented and is real world. And so that's a huge piece out here.
Yeah, a real example is we spent really no time on the Torrey Pines. And since the eradication of deer and elk, we still spent no time on the Torrey Pines. It wasn't until the university decided to have a capstone student look at the Torrey Pines. And now we actually know how many Torrey Pines we have. We know their health condition. We also have learned that they're actually spreading.
Yeah.
They're doing really well. And now I pay more attention to Torrey Pines and I've realized, oh my gosh, ever since we got rid of the deer and elk, they actually are flourishing, but now we actually have data that can show it. The park did not invest in that, the university did.
Yeah, and that's the nice thing about this park, right, is here's the rarest pine species, or one of the rarest pine species in the world. We go in there, and maybe the estimate's like 5,000 individuals. Well, we go in there as a team with the National Park staff, USGS staff, park faculty members and undergrads, and we find out 22,000 individuals in this forest, 80% of the population in the world. The beautiful thing about these islands is they offer a sense of hope, right? When I taught as a PhD student, I taught environmental science at Berkeley. And in that case, at the very end of that semester, I realized I did something wrong. Because here's like bright-eyed, bushy-tailed undergrads saving the world. And at the end, they're like, what can we do? Like human population, you know, habitat destruction, all these different pieces. And part of that reflected the system I worked in Hawaii. Well, here, foxes just got delisted, the fastest recovery ever.
This island.
Yeah, of all islands. Delisted across all the
islands. Well, and like Russell mentioned, the marine protected areas, right? Strategy that pulled in all the stakeholders to identify where the MPAs are. And after 10 years, amazing results. You got a dynamic system of Santa Rosa Island. For the first time, introduced grazers are out here after 150 years. This island is in a dynamic state, really changing, right when the university comes on board. So there's perfect research opportunities to document the recovery process. And so when students leave here, regardless of what they've been doing, they have the opportunity to nurture the landscape, contribute to the landscape, and acknowledge the land that they inhabit. And they leave with a sense of hope, and ideally a new sense of place and a new sense of community itself. And so that's the biggest transformation that we try to offer out here. So for undergraduate research, for instance...
I'm thinking back to the book that When the Killing's Done.
Yeah.
How do you... So you have... you have to get rid of the elk to restore the island back to what it looked like, you know, 1,000 years ago, 100 years ago. But you have to deal with the political ramifications of the species you're deciding didn't belong there to get back to the time frame you were. How do you... I guess that's really more of a national park question.
Let's say Cosfish, I love to tell that story because the real story is actually better than the book. And
about the snake? Because that was an awful...
I don't think that's real. That's not a real part of the story.
That was like my... Oh, my gosh!
Well, but that's exactly... You take that same snake thing, and that's really the big story. It's really a deer and elk story. So, you know, it just so happens that was the next story to think about. Mm-hmm. So we can talk about that. I'd be happy since I lived through the whole thing. Yeah.
But it's an interesting comparison, these islands and what you would have to do versus an island that's inhabited. Right. You know, like Hawaii or Catalina. And now you have a cultural connection to pigs. Well, good luck ever eradicating that species. And now you're fencing. And you're doing probably about 60% of the budget in Hawaii volcanoes is fencing, and you get bog coming in and destroying the fence. So it's like this never-ending system. Where out here, the national park has done a phenomenal job, and it had the opportunity to remove that threat. And now the island, I mean, come back in 10 years, you know, this island's going to be completely different.
But last 3-4 years, mm-hmm. I'm a political scientist, not a biologist, but it's evident.
Right.
The changes.
Mm-hmm. But there is a political, that's what I'm saying, there's because how do you determine what the state is that you're trying to return to?
Well,
so if the pigs have been here 1,000 years, and now you're deciding, well, we want it to go back to what was your...
It's a conversation, right?
Right.
And you have to frame it properly.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I remember one time when I was doing a thing up at, when I was up at Stanford, and we wanted to get rid of non-native critters, and this lady came up with a British accent. She said, "I'm not native. You want to get rid of me?" You know, and it was like, no. So I think a lot of it is actually framing it. So the answer is not, do we want to kill or not kill the pig? The answer is, do you want all these birds to go extinct? Is that's what you want, right? Mm-hmm. So you're saying you want to kill those birds? No, I don't want to kill those birds. Then you can actually have a conversation. But if it seems to become solely about an organism-focused thing as opposed to a population or community or societal-level thing,
or sustainability,
then you lose the argument. You have to have the broader context. And unfortunately, a lot of people in society don't have that broader context.
Right. So with the foxes, it was the bald eagle that was the problem?
The golden eagle.
Yeah. How was that issue resolved? Because I guess I read the first story in the paper and not the second.
See, that's related to the pig.
It's all related
to the pig,
which is related to DDT. It's all interwoven.
So Jacqui, where it comes with us is first we'd like to remind people is that the American people set a value when they established this as a park. So when Congress wrote the legislation, first of all, there is our Organic Act that says we are to conserve the scenery and the wildlife and historic objects therein for the enjoyment of future generations in an unimpaired condition. So that's what Congress set out in 1916 when they set up the Park Service. So that's our foundation there. And when they further set up Channel Islands, they also said that we were to manage this to make sure there were no negligible adverse impacts. There would be carrying capacities. And there were certain ecosystems they wanted us to pay particular attention to. It's the same legislation that also said nothing in this law would diminish the state's authority over the marine resources. So it was very clear. So when you put those two together, it starts to develop what the value system is, the baseline in which you start. So then the next question is, as you had already alluded to, is, so what do you bring it back to? Did you pick a point in time to bring it back to? And what Kate Faulkner and I would always say is, we didn't pick a point in time. What we did is we want to restore the natural processes to protect what Congress had already set as the value system that the people set as a value system. So when you look at how did pigs get here, they were brought here by an entrepreneur when it was private land who wanted to make it a pig farm. And then they go broke and they decide the best thing to do is just let the pigs go free. All right, so they weren't native to the island. Nothing in our legislation says you would protect the wildlife. Okay, pigs aren't wildlife, you know. They are not in that term. They are wild because they've been out here for 150 years, but they're not wildlife. They weren't native to the islands. It's the same with the horses and things of that nature. So you start to make those, they are value questions, and bring the public along with you is, do you agree with this? And of course, in each one of those, we did NEPA documentation. And just so you know, when we got rid of the rats, we were sued in federal court. Well, again, you see, you can't separate rats from pigs, you know, because the way you look at it is, how did you make the determination that they were non-native? And there, a lot of it is going back to what Sean said. It was, are some trade-offs. You know, you can have rats, but you have to know then you're not going to have Scripps Merlets anymore. And Scripps Merlets have this range that only goes from Baja up to here. You know, a bird that fits in the palm of my hand. A bird that after it hatches, so 2 days after that chick hatches from Anacapa Island, 2 days, it looks like a cotton ball. Mom flies down 120 feet to the ocean and chirps up at that chick. And that chick jumps off the cliff, hits the cliff on the way down, hits the water, gets on mom's back, will never return to that island until it's sexually mature. Stays at sea forever until it's sexually mature. So you ask yourself, that bird who only has this much range, should it be able to survive? Okay, so that's one question you ask. You know, the other is, what about the native mice that are out there? You know, and how are the rats impacting them? Or what about the lizards that are out there? How are they changing the ecosystem, the rat? And then how the rat get there? And everybody suspects it got there through a shipwreck. So there are no native rats, except for wood rats and I think like pocket rats or pocket gopher type things in North America. These are black rats. You know, they are from Asia. Is that right, John?
Europe.
Yeah. So they're from Europe. And they come with people. So then always the question comes, at what point do you start to naturalize these other critters? Well, these are islands. And what we know on islands is rats and goats and cats and cattle, hoofed animals, you really change the ecosystem. So we put all that together and say, well, it's time to get rid of the rats. So we get rid of the rats. And that's how we did the same thing with the pig, but the pig was much more complicated because we know the pig played into foxes. Why do they play in the foxes? Because the pig puts out 2 litters a year. That sow puts out 2 litters of about 9 piglets. And piglets are the perfect size for golden eagles. Not anecdotally, what we know through the records is nobody ever really records nesting golden eagles on these islands. Nobody will ever say golden eagles didn't ever come out here. It's that they never set up territories on these islands. Well, why wouldn't they have set up territories? 2 reasons. There were bald eagles prior to 1950, and there's lots of records of bald eagles. And the second thing is there was not a food supply that could sustain them. So even though you had foxes, there weren't enough foxes to sustain them. So you have to have a population that sustains them. And then people, you know, right away is, well, what's the difference between the bald and the golden? Well, if you know anything about bald eagles, they eat primarily fish and carrion, dead things. Goldens go after live prey, and mainly packages about the size of a piglet. So you got the perfect thing. Bald eagles are extirpated because of DDT. They're no longer on the islands. Golden eagles can move in and now set up shop. There's no competition, at least for territorial competition, and there's a plentiful food source. The fox evolves over time without an aerial predator. Foxes are out during the day. We'll probably see some as when we're out here. So if you're not finding pigs, the goldens are finding foxes. So we saw fox populations almost completely destroyed in the late 90s. We were down to 13 and 15 foxes, respectively. 15 on this big island. This entire island, only 15 foxes. We captured every single one of them. And then the same with over on San Miguel, 13. Put them all in the captive breeding. So it became a very intricate ecological question. And complicated one is, what do you do? So we put together a whole NEPA document that was, put bald eagles back. And on the drive, I got lots of bald eagle stories. Take golden eagles off. Get rid of the pigs. Put the foxes in captive breeding. Rear them so that you can put them back into the wild. So it was all put together. And the other big push for getting rid of the pigs is because of the native. What's so beautiful about these islands is there's no ground burrowing animals. Even the mouse that's out here only goes just below the surface. Even burrowing owls just go below the surface. So nobody's taking and going straight down and digging things up and really changing the stratigraphy of the island archaeology. So it's a great place to study archaeology. Nothing's getting mixed up. So the pigs were destroying the archaeology. They were coming in like a bulldozer, just ripping it all up. And what else they do is they're now getting the land ready for the other exotic plants to take over, like fennel. So there was not only looking at the pig for the fox, but looking at the spread of exotics and also the disturbance of archaeological resources. So it was this big puzzle. Put them back, put things back. As we say, ecosystem management is about managing the pieces, managing a puzzle. And you know there's nothing more frustrating when you get into the puzzle and go, where does this piece go?
There's no corner.
And you go, well, that piece doesn't belong. Well, how do you get it in the box? It's time for it to get out of the box, right? Or, I'm missing a piece. Who's missing? In this case, the piece that was in the box was the golden eagle. The piece that was missing was the bald eagle. And the other piece that was there that wasn't supposed to be there were all the pigs. So you had all these extra pieces in there. You couldn't build the ecosystem back. Couldn't build that puzzle back. And the fox was falling off the table. So we couldn't ever finish the puzzle. So that's how we like to look at it, is it was like putting together a big puzzle.
So you were going to tell the story at some point how you got there.
But now you kept pushing me, so I had to give it to you. So how did you get to the political part, right?
You have the golden eagle, the bald eagle and the golden eagle.
So we did NEPA and did public meetings. And in fact, if you ever saw T.C. Boyle, he actually had a trailer for his book. He's one of the only authors who does trailers for his books. You probably could still watch it. And it's the scene in the Santa Barbara Natural History Museum when, the guy's name is Lovejoy, I think that's his name. He stands up and he questions, what's going on. It's a very dark scene. Well, that event actually happened. I was on stage with Lotus Vermeer. And I'm not mentioned in the book, hardly at all, which is great.
You were in the book.
I am in the book, yeah. But a very, very small part.
Lotus gets a pretty big part.
Lotus, but she's actually combined with Kate. Lotus and Kate are actually combined.
Right.
But Lotus and I are on stage. And let me tell you what really happened at that meeting. It was pretty anti-government. It was pretty anti-killing the pigs. But then there was a local veterinarian in Santa Barbara who started thinking, and she was against the park over removing horses on Santa Cruz Island. And there was this big push about heritage horses and that these horses have been out here forever, so they should be managed like cultural resources. But she stood up and she said, I happen to have my difference of opinion with the National Park Service, but on this particular occasion, I think they are right. The pigs need to go. And all of a sudden, all those people who supported the Nature Conservancy and the Park Service started to stand up and say, we agree. It's just one person. That's what it took, one person, who was pretty respected, I think, in that community, to stand up and say, it is the right thing to do. But then the question was, because Lois Capps asked me to meet with two people because they were very upset over us eradicating the pigs through killing. So then there was the piece of, and that's why it's called When the Killing's Done, is, you know, do you kill them? And then the question is, if you're going to manage pigs, are you managing them? Are you controlling them, or are you eradicating them? And I want you to know, we've been always very clear, we eradicate species. Because controlling means you're telling the government to invest long-term in management of a non-native species. And so we would go for eradication. So there's that piece to it, is getting the public to come along with it. But when I met with these individuals, they also wanted to know, why couldn't you just sterilize the pigs and give them a remote contraceptive? Because that's actually done in some places. But the question is, are you controlling or eradicating? And if you imagine, if, you know, not to pick on you too, but, you know, if you're running around, I'd have to put tags on you, and I'd have to make sure I caught you every so many months and shot you with, you know, a birth control device. And then I don't know if it worked, you know? So that becomes very onerous on the government to try and figure out how that works. But I met with them, and they gave me a professor's name and said, you know, we've been working with this professor, and we want you to check into this because we think you can do it this way, and maybe they all just die out naturally. So we called the professor, and we explained to him the situation, and he said, no, that won't work. And we said, okay, we knew it wouldn't work either, but we had to check with you because we promised Lowe's Caps we would talk to these people. So we talked to him, and then one of them sued us anyway. And I want you to know that that's a happy story too. Because at the end, 2 years ago, Mr. Feldman, he's actually in West of the West. Yeah. He what?
He's using UV eyeglasses.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh, I thought you said he died last night. I was like, oh, no. But Mr. Feldman, he's the one who sued us. It went to the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals. That's how, he felt he was being harmed. But there was an eyeglass factory add-on about all the nice work he does in donating glasses. And this was 2 years after the pig eradication. I decided I was going to call Rick. And I called him. And because I was moved by the story. I thought it was a fascinating story. And I figured, look, I got to get over this. And he needs to be complimented. I called him. He said he was going to call me. I said, why? He said, you were just in the newspaper. Oh, no, you saw me on Key 3 about something else. I said, well, why would you want to call me? He said, you know, you were right. I go, what do you mean I was right? And he said, I'm sorry I drug you through all those lawsuits. You were right. I said, Rick, you know, it's not about being right or wrong. It's about, you felt passionate about what you were doing. I felt passionate. And I'm glad you see that what we did made some sense. And still, I'm trying to meet with Rick to come back out and see this. But he saw it differently after it had all occurred. And I think that that's what we try and do I think as Sean said, is that you lay the values out, but it's also trying to get people to say, well, what is it you love about these islands? And if you love them, then there are some things you got to do that are very difficult. But you do it with science, you do it with politics, you do it with decision making. There's lots of ways to do it. But it was so contentious, and you can ask Lois. There was a congressman who tried to cut this island out of the park in 2006. And conference committee on a bill to go to war with Iraq.
Dan, so do we?
We're going to be waiting for the.
Oh, we're going to wait for the. Okay.
Yeah. So there's lots of great stories, and I think that.
But
this,
okay,
this,
so
this builds the university
to,
story. Did I answer your question?
Eagle. Well, just the
eagle. Oh, the eagle. Okay.
If you introduce the bald eagle, does the golden go away?
No, we didn't reestablished.
Reestablished.
No,
okay,
we...
Okay, reestablished, sorry.
They were here. They were here.
Right. They were killed, yeah, the
and
DDT.
Because of the DDT.
Right.
So we worked with Alaska and the San Francisco Zoo. There's actually hack stations. Mark didn't point them out, but there's hack stations still up on Santa Cruz where we brought in birds that were ready to fledge. And to be released, and so they stayed in their cages for a while, overlooking the ocean. They were fed, and then when they were ready to fly, they lifted the door, and they would take off whenever they wanted.
How do we know any of us are healthy? Well, it's the vital signs. What's your pulse? You know, what's your temperature? Are her eyes dilated? You know, is she breathing? And so that's how kind of the inventory monitoring system is broken up into these vital signs. Well, sandy beach, intertidal, fox monitoring, native veg, tree demography, climate. And these are projects that we've all jumped on as undergraduates that they can plug right into. And so we have a variety of projects, over a dozen, that are legacy projects that students repeatedly plug into, provide data with the oversight of the national park, myself or somebody else, and now we're developing these long-term data sets into the future, which should help, hopefully, with natural and cultural resource management. Looks like we have some of our folks coming in. Their visitors don't represent the demography of our country.
That's right.
And that's a huge issue. And for this park in particular, I grew up in the area, big family, and I never would have dreamed about the opportunity to get out to these islands, right? There's no way my family would afford it. There's a socioeconomic divide of that boat ticket. And so this park, they've been doing a really good job, but there's still this interface of the local community who should be the stewards, who should be the people fighting for the integrity of this park. Well, why would they care if they don't have access, if they don't have that experience out here? And so that's what our award was about. That's what working with the National Park is about, is we're working not only with the undergrads at our university, who are mostly from the local counties, but we have an education program that we've established with NOAA and school district funding in a partnership that we developed. And it's called Crossing the Channel. And so we've worked with over 600 students, been in the classrooms for over 3,000 hours.
Really? Even the very end? Is there a number for the...
10-10.
10-10.
10-10. Yeah. So, like today, we have two faculty members working in Oxnard State Park with two classes from Fremont. And so that's run through the research station distance learning opportunity. So these are students who have never maybe even had access to the beach, but they're going to be doing professional research. They're doing marine debris protocol with NOAA, they're doing microplastics, and they're doing sandy beach ecology. And so that's all funded through the research station, but provides a distance learning activity. And so these students are going to be doing a series of activities on the mainland with the culminating activity of coming out here at the research station and working with us. And so those students, which is really cool, are working with high school students, professionals, and junior high schools. And initially, they don't see themselves as scientists. Maybe they see a scientist as an old white guy in a lab coat. But at the end, they recognize themselves as scientists, but not only scientists, but active members of the scientific community, stewards of the landscape, contributing scientists, because they've been collecting data this whole time. And so that's one of the processes we've had. And thinking about longitudinal progresses, we've had junior high school students working in this program. Now as high school students, they're revisiting this program. And we've had students that were recruiting to CI in environmental science, biology, and anthro that have done our program, because now they see the pathway, they see that there's jobs available, and they're confident that they're able to contribute. And so that's one of our big programs that we have when it comes to distance learning and working with local school districts, whether it's elementary or high school districts. If you look at our research use, just to kind of do a quick summary, again, we continue to increase. We had a 45% increase this past year in use, and the vast majority of our use is undergrad, so that's our priority and that's our emphasis, particularly CI students. And again, we've almost had every single program out here. And so we're consistently going back to faculty members and seeing how they can plug in. And so whether that's anthropology, which is a pretty easy fit, but communications comes out here. And this is something that Russell mentioned. I work with a communications faculty member, and we did a sibling trip. So here's students from CI bringing their siblings out here. And in the data, it's recorded, you know, like if you integrate your family, well, that's a much more long-lasting experience. And so now we're integrating into the community with that trip. Or whether it's English, we do environmental lit. We have them contribute to the photo monitoring program. Performing arts, we're going to be working with this year. Mathematics, statisticians are working with some of the long-term monitoring data. And so there's always a way to plug in for all these disciplines. And I think that's the new kind of overall goal and realization in this community is, man, it shouldn't be driven by biology, environmental science, anthropology. Every single discipline should have a perspective and a buy-in to this system, right? And a connection.
So when you're saying communications, shouldn't those students be doing more like social, Twitter, Facebook?
Yes, and we've also
they should
had,
be.
Yeah, we've also had a student work as an independent project with our social media, our programming. We've had business students look at our processes and protocols, our marketing, and so everything. All these students are contributing to the welfare of the station and the progression.
Because if all the kids that have been here are able to contribute on Facebook, like in an ongoing way, keep everybody connected.
Yeah.
So is that happening?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, good. For sure. Yeah, and so we have students.
What's the Twitter handle?
Of ours?
Yeah.
SRRS.
Oh.
Yeah. And so we have our social media forum, and most of it's driven by students, in addition to some of us who contribute every once in a while.
So is that a test, Jacqui?
Yeah.
I just wanted to make sure
students
made
as they're
doing their job.
No, for sure. It is. It's a big piece, right? How do we communicate with that next generation? What's the appropriate
level? It wasn't a test. It's when I do my tweet. S-R-I-R-S.
Yeah.
Okay.
Santa Rosa Island Research Station.
Okay. And another piece I think I just want to emphasize is how many partners we have. And so coming back to the creation of this research station, those individuals had a buy-in. They had a voice in what the station, what the priorities, what the mission of the station was. And ever since then, they've contributed and utilized this research station. And so if you look at partners, we have school districts ranging from LA, Ventura County, up to Santa Barbara County. We have universities, over 27 universities used this research station last year. So we're developing partnerships among faculty members and research opportunities for our faculty and other faculty. We have governmental and then nonprofit. And so again, this is a research station that's utilized by a whole bunch of people. And more importantly, it's occupied by a variety of institutes at the same time, right? And that gets these discussions, whether it's between two faculty members or researchers going, whoa, there's this collaboration happening. Or whether it's a student that gets an internship or a job, which we've had plenty with these conversations and these partnerships going on right now. Like we've had a student get hired by Cornell, working with some of the pine species, or a student that got an internship with NOAA, right? And these conversations start here, these relationships start here, which is pretty phenomenal.
So how do you look though at government partners? Because obviously you have the National Park Service, but I look at something like microplastics, mm-hmm. and a lot of the research should be they should be looking at policy that might help these issues. So is there the political science part, how do you push policies at the state and federal level?
Yeah, so that's a perfect example. So we just got through the research station and partners environmental science faculty, we got a two-year grant, NOAA grant, looking at marine debris. On that grant, we've integrated anthropology, art, and then environmental science and biology, so an interdisciplinary grant, which currently I'm the lead on. That research with Sandy Beach Ecology, micro and macro debris, is informing policy. And so we're working directly with Channel Islands Natural Marine Sanctuary and have a direct conversation with the commercial and recreational fishermen here. And so the idea is to look at how marine debris has changed over these past 20 years, and just our pilot data, marine debris has increased by about 40%. So now we've identified the culprit, the issue. Well, what's the issue? There are lobster traps, derelict fishing gear, an issue for the local ecology. Well, that over the next 2 years, we'll be able to say this is the impact it's having on local habitat and organisms. Well, what are policy that we can provide to limit derelict fishing gear, right? The first step of it though is identifying whose issue it is, and if it's having an impact locally. And so we've been working with Channel Islands National Marine Sanctuary with that conversation. One of the first things that's going to be happening is next year, after this year, they're going to be reducing the number of pots or traps by about half that each permit holder can do, right?
Lobster traps,
yeah. And so we'll be seeing this next year, well, is that having an impact? Is that a policy that's actually benefiting the local ecology? If not, we'll have the data to provide it and then go back to the policy table to see if we can limit some of these impacts.
But it's also accountability on the traps.
Exactly.
And you have to show that you have the same number you started with.
Right.
Because right now there's not much incentive if you lose your traps and then they end up ghost fishing. They're still fishing, except they have no buoy to the top. And if they end up in shallow water, cormorants are swimming down into them, going into the trap, then they can't get out. Mm-hmm. So we're drowning seabirds. So and it's unknowing to the fishermen because they don't know where their trap is.
Right.